From WBUR Boston, I'm Tom Ashbrook, and this is On Point. The Arab world has packed a whole lot of history into the last 12 months. The Arab Spring, Arab uprisings, they had a history of their own, but anyone who keeps a sharp eye on the region will tell you this chapter has barely begun. The old order is not going gently. Egypt's generals have picked a fight with Washington. Syria's Assad fights and lets the bodies pile up. And new ways bring new tensions between secular and religious reformers. This hour on Point, how the Arab Spring confrontations really begin now. You can join the conversation. Is it time for the U.S. to cut off Egypt's generals? Where is this long, hard, amazing springtime headed? You can comment at our website, onpointradio.org, or on Twitter and Facebook at On Point Radio. Joining me first today from London, England, is Marwan Bishara. Marwan Bishara, senior political analyst for Al Jazeera English and host of the show Empire on Al Jazeera. His new book is The Invisible Arab, The Promise and Perils of the Arab Revolution. Marwan Bishara, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
So you write in your book about the fall and rise of the Arabs. We've seen the rise. Remind us of the fall.
You know, Tom, the fall came after the Arabs liberated their lands from colonial powers. And somewhere along the line, a few years after they did, they plunged into a world of dictatorships, autocrats of all sorts, secular, religious, nationalists and hyper-nationalists that simply repressed their people. The land was liberated, but not the people. And for many decades, in some countries since the 40s and others since the 70s, the entire Arab world has lived under repressive regimes, dictatorships that cared very little about their people's welfare and very much for their own welfare, and in so many ways committed the worst massacres or the worst repression and torture of Arabs and set them back many decades while the world made important progress. Mm-hmm. The Arabs fell behind.
Now, we've still got all these problems. I want to dive into them. I'm so curious to what you think about the situation in Egypt and well beyond. But you write, Marwan, in your book, you say, despite everything that's going on, and it's not over, you write, fasten your seatbelt, it's going to be bumpy, but you say that you sincerely believe that the peoples of the region have made a decisive break with the past. Define that break. What is that decisive break you see as having been made with the past?
You know, we have 70% of the Arab world is under the 25 years of age. We have an entire new generation that simply broke the barrier of fear. They poured to the streets, to the public squares of the Arab world. In countries where they actually changed regimes, like in Tunisia and Egypt, and others where they took time and violently took over their regimes, like in Libya, and in others, like in Yemen, where they went through transition, and yet in other Arakatos where they are struggling today, an entire new generations, which I would like to call the miracle generation of Arabs, those young people who everyone thought of as a demographic burden on the Arab world, turned out to be the one generation after the liberation generation and the defeated generation and the lost generation of the 1990s, suddenly we have this new generation that broke the barrier of fear and decided to break with the past. This generation, I think, will no longer accept repressive regimes the way we saw them before. They'd ask and demand for new freedoms, for new freedom of expression, for new freedoms for work, for assembly, for practicing their beliefs, and so on and so forth. It's clear to me that even the conservative religious forces now are, if I might use the word, Tom, schmoozing the spirit of the new generation of freedom and democracy. And I think in that sense, we might go in all sorts of directions, but the repressive dictatorships of the past, I don't think will revisit the region anytime soon.
I want to look at those Islamic forces who are schmoozing with the secular sort of freedom generation, as you describe it. But I'm not so sure even just about the repressive forces. I mean, look at Egypt right now. Yes, Hosni Mubarak is long gone, but the generals who are around him are still there and still in power. They still control an enormous chunk of the economy. They still got great sway, even as we have elections in Egypt. Has Egypt really gotten rid of the repressive regime, or is it still living right in the middle of it?
That's a very important nuance that you're making, Tom. Very important. Look, in Egypt, unlike, for example, in Tunisia to a certain degree, what we had is in the midst of the revolution, as people were on their way to rid themselves of the repressive regime, parts of the regime, the military in this sense, turned against the leader. There was a coup d'etat within the regime against the dictator Mubarak. So in the midst of the revolution, we had a coup d'etat. And hence, we have mixed results now. On the one hand, we have people who basically revolted against the dictatorship and who continue today and have, Tom, over the last year, continued their struggle, the revolution against the dictatorship of all its manifestations, including the military. And yes, we have the military who helped the revolution in the beginning by mounting this coup d'etat against Mubarak and his sons and his clique of corrupted officials. And yes, they are with us to stay. However, because of the public pressure, because the public pressure continues, because every Friday young people are still pouring to the streets, because the civil society is active in Egypt, there is so much pressure on the generals that they must relinquish power by June of this year. Yes, there is an evolution after the revolution. And yes, this evolution might take time. But what I'm looking at, Tom, I'm looking at the trend. And the trend is the military is on the defensive. The people are on the offensive in Egypt.
Are you confident that, again, just taking Egypt as one example, we have other places where the conflict is still so dire. I mean, look at Syria, but let's take Egypt. Do you think it's going to end up in a kind of free, open democracy that we heard described and chanted for in Tahrir Square a year ago, or in some, you know, significantly compromised version of that?
Well, certainly democracy is an ideal. Democratic processes take long time. And democratic processes, and I agree with you here, Tom, they're not about slogans. So people could have all the slogans they want, but at the end of the day, democracy is not just about rights, it's also about responsibilities. And it will take an entire new generation, and it will take middle classes of sort, because, you know, for your viewers in America and, of course, in other places, it's very important to make clear that that democracy is a historical process that came at a certain time when middle classes were expansive and powerful, where civil society was strong. And I think once we develop the culture, the political and social culture, when we develop the middle classes, the working classes in the Arab world to take on the responsibility of democracy, we will have a more prosperous democracy. For the time being, what we have is an agenda, our slogans, and a spirit towards freedom. The way to realize the spirit and to implement those slogans will take time. And I think the time is on the side of the Egyptian people. There will be wide zigzags. There will be ups and downs. There will be disappointments. We've seen that in other democratic revolutions, the French, the Americans, and others. We will see that in Egypt. But I think, as I said, the trend is on the side of the people.
So there's the trend. But within, if you're right, what does that trend bring? We see tension being described now between kind of secular reformers and religious reformers who want to put Islam more front and center. Tunisia, where it all began, we're reading here, New York Times says, you know, today that there's a contest for the soul of the country now. A secular rally over the last weekend, thousands of people in downtown Tunis, one of the biggest demonstrations in months. And those secular reformers are holding up a banner that says, make a common front against fanaticism. And they're pushing there against stern Islam, I guess, Marwan. What about that contest within a freer political situation?
If I might, Tom, if you allow me to contextualize this just for a moment, let's look at what happened just this past year. In Egypt, the infamous security repressive forces were dismembered. The puppet parliament was dismembered. The the ruling party, the corrupt, repressive ruling party, was dismembered. The last constitution was basically scrapped, and a reformed constitution was voted on. New elections were held on the constitution and for parliament.
It's a lot. It's a lot.
And the president, who was there for the last 30 years, mm-hmm. was seen being dragged to prison one day after another. So in so many ways, we've seen a lot happening the last year. So I would say...
Credit given. That's a huge list that you just put out there. Right. We need to acknowledge it.
That's right. Here you go. So we have that. Now, what we have today is true elections that... The way I see it, Tom, it's more anchored in the past than in the future. Meaning, several months after we have a revolution in Egypt and Tunisia, people are voting for those who they are familiar with. The Muslim Brotherhood and the other Islamists, as in Tunisia and other places, are the ones who the people are most familiar with, because they were the ones who left standing after the repressive policies of the last several decades. Those are the ones who had the social and the medical networks in the poor neighborhoods. Those are the ones who struggled against the repressive regimes and stayed standing. So for so many people who voted for the first time in their lifetimes, yes, they voted for those who were known to be the antithesis of the repressive, so-called secular populist regimes.
I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point, and we're talking this hour about the Arab world right now. A year after the Arab Spring, Egyptian generals on the hot seat in Washington, near war in Syria, Islamists in power, protesters still in the streets. The sound right there from Tahrir Square just last week, marking the one-year anniversary of the start of the uprising that toppled Hosni Mubarak. It has not been an easy year. A lot has been accomplished, but there are still deep tensions and deep questions. Back in November, Egyptians amazed even themselves earlier in the year, having dislodged Hosni Mubarak, the longtime ruler. As the months went by, military waffled on reforms. Citizens kept up their protests. Here in November, the military decided it was time to crack down on the same protesters who had pushed Mubarak out. Big standoff right now between Washington and that military in Cairo. But of course, it's not just in Egypt where there are still big problems. Deeply unresolved situation in Syria. Regime has worked ruthlessly to stay in power. Many, many dead there. Growing body count has not deterred protesters, army defectors, or the political opposition. In recent days, fighting has made its way right to the outskirts of the capital, Damascus. Here's a reporter for Al Jazeera English describing the situation in Syria, Damascus.
In the suburbs of the capital, Damascus, battles rage as anti-government fighters take on government forces in a battle to regain control over these neighborhoods. Activists say the Syrian army shelled towns and villages with artillery fire, cut off power supplies, water and phone lines. The opposition Free Syrian Army says its troops are fighting back and inflicting serious losses amongst government forces. People are fleeing from the battle, but there's nowhere safe to go.
All that was started a year ago, still very much underway, and in some countries, very much up in the air. Marwan Bishara is with us today. His new book is The Invisible Arab, The Promise and Perils of the Arab Revolution. He joins us from London. Marwan Bishara, please stand by in London. With us right now as well from Washington is Robin Wright, senior fellow at the U.S. Institute of Peace, distinguished scholar at the Wilson Center, longtime correspondent reporting from the Middle East, just returned from a trip to Cairo. Her most recent book is Rock the Kasbah, Rage and Rebellion Across the Islamic World. Robin Wright, thank you very much for being with us.
Hi, Tom.
Can we just go to this U.S.-Egypt standoff right now? There's so many angles to this, and Marwan has helped us begin to walk in to it. But we've got Americans who were denied exit from Egypt by the Egyptian government. And today, Egyptian generals in Washington, I guess, in the hot seat. What's going on with this relationship, Robin?
It's an extraordinary moment. And there are many people on the Hill who said just 3 weeks ago there would never be any kind of cutback on U.S. aid to Egypt, which goes back now to the Camp David peace accords in the late 1970s and totals over $30 billion. But because of the very unusual steps taken by the Egyptian military in raiding 17 American NGOs, non-government organizations in Cairo, confiscating cash, computers, calling in for questioning many of the staffers. The United States is now really at wit's end. President Obama called Field Marshal Tantawi, who's the effective head of state. He's the head of the Supreme Council for the Armed Forces. Secretary Hillary Clinton and others have called their counterparts to say, we have to resolve this crisis. This is unprecedented. And in fact, I was told by someone from the National Democratic Institute that in the 30 years of U.S. democracy programs around the world, this is the first time that American NGOs have been treated this way. They didn't. This kind of thing didn't even happen when the Ortegas ruled in Nicaragua, you know, a century ago. And so there's deep frustration. And it also plays into this broader question of, will the generals really hand over power? And that's really at the heart of what happens next in Egypt. We in the West have been more focused on, well, the Islamist parties have won the election. But the real issue is, will we see this handover of power in June as scheduled? There's a deep sense, a deep skepticism in Cairo that the generals will really come clean on their economic assets, will not try to intervene in foreign policy and legislation as they have in the past. We've neglected to fully understand the extent to which Egypt was a military state, that all the presidents since the 1952 revolution have been military men. And today, the military really controls the country and is trying to protect not only its power, but also its privileges.
And, of course, the charge made here is that foreign money has been interfering in Egyptian politics. Therefore, the raids and the charges against some of those NGOs, Americans denied permission to leave the country, including the son of Secretary for Transportation, Ray LaHood, right there in the heart of the Obama administration. Congress threatening now to cut off some or all of the $1.3 billion annual in aid to Egypt. You had the NGO, the International Republican Institute, and the National Democratic Institute, the NDI, both doing this promoting democracy work there. Here's a little tape, Robin, Marwan, from Senator John McCain. He originally put out a statement expressing alarm and outrage. Here he is on CNN yesterday in a more tempered moment, defending the work of those pro-democracy American NGOs, non-governmentalist organizations.
These organizations have been in many, many countries many times. They don't sway anybody's public opinion. They help them with the fundamentals of democracy. It was a Reagan idea, by the way, and I'm proud of the work that NDI International Republican Institute have done under the National Endowment for Democracy. We've done great work, and why they're doing this, I don't know. And by the way, Sam LaHood was doing a great job over there.
Sam LaHood, as in the son of a cabinet member in the Obama cabinet. Robin, I want to dig deeper with you into the general situation. But Marwan Bishara, what do you make of this? What's happening with these generals who for so long have been funded by the United States? If they're expected to bring democracy or allow democracy to flourish in their country, what are they doing pushing back against people who are there to, presumably to help do that?
Tom, I think we need to nuance this complicated question. So let me start by agreeing that the military, the generals, probably have all sorts of intentions and motivations that are not net, that are not exactly humanitarian or democratic or,
to say the least,
correct.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Yes. So there's no doubt about that. And I think it's part of their populist ways of distracting the main battle that's going on in Egypt to basically force them to transition to civilian power. So there's no doubt about that. Mm-hmm. However, having said that, I don't agree with Senator McCain that since the International Republican Institute worked in other places, that makes it correct to work in Egypt today. I don't think America, the United States of America, would like it very much if the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt would have an arm, an NGO arm, called the International Muslim Brotherhood, to be actively financing all sorts of political work in the United States during election year. I think for a long time, the Egyptian military, aside from its corruption and nepotism, did represent a certain questions of sovereignty for Egypt, and these are important for the Egyptians. What worries me here, Tom, is one single matter. Mm-hmm. Instead of us having this clear battle line between Egyptians and the generals. We're slowly but surely distracted by some sort of an American IRI Egyptian conflict that there is no place for it in today's Egypt. I think we need to leave the Egyptians to fight their battle, their democratic battle. They've done very well over the last year. There is no need for this distraction with Washington this time, because the last thing you need in the Arab world today, Tom, is for the pro-democracy movement in Egypt and the rest of the Arab world to be associated with the Republican Party or any other party in the United States.
Robin, what about it? This is maybe a time when Americans should not be mucking about in Egyptian politics, and yet it's supposed to be a free time.
Well, the Egyptian military has been incredibly clumsy in the way it's handled this and allowed it to become such a prolonged issue, and that forcing Americans to actually take refuge in the American embassy in Cairo, unprecedented, really. But there is a sense that throughout the Arab world today, in part because of the U.S. intervention in Iraq in 2003, that lasted 9 years, and the U.S. intervention in Afghanistan, which continues after more than a decade, that a lot of Muslim countries don't want a strong American presence. There's a growing kind of xenophobia about, let us craft our own new order. We don't want it dictated or shaped or defined by outside forces. And I don't think that's what NDI or IRI were trying to do. They were really trying to actually help some of the young revolutionaries who actually turned out at Tahrir Square a year ago, mm-hmm. and who don't have the resources, the experience to craft a campaign, to know how to run for office, to fight for women's rights, to define an agenda that most of these institutions are not telling what people what to believe, but just trying to explain the democratic process to them. And that's fairly innocent enough, but it is, as always, perception. And there is a perception among many that the U.S. is trying to push some of these political, you know, these new fragile new states in a certain direction. And, of course, the military is trying to exploit that sensitivity because of their general reaction and growing reaction against its own rule. So it's a way of playing to popular sentiment and saying, oh, it's their fault. You know, the kind of tensions inside the country. It's the Americans and others who are trying to intervene and determine our future.
Robin, could you introduce us to this powerful Egyptian woman now, the Minister of International Cooperation, Feza Abul Naga, who's really been pushing this drive against the foreign NGOs. She's described, the Wall Street Journal describes her now as one of the most powerful women in Egypt, a potential presidential candidate in the June election coming up. And she's gotten into this position by being very nationalistic in her rhetoric, a lot of defiance of the West, but also close ties to the military, which is standing in the way of democracy. So is this let us craft our own new order, or is this smother the new order in its cradle, you know, under a blanket of xenophobia?
I think that the latter, the bottom line. Everyone in Egypt is waiting for the other shoe to drop over the presidential contest. This is, after all, still an executive presidential system. Parliament was just elected. It's going to write a new constitution. But as it stands today, the president is the most important power in Egypt. And there are many who are waiting to see if the military does put forward a candidate in an attempt to protect its own interests, whether it's this particular woman or a former general, someone who will represent their long-term interests. And they will smother it, as you pointed out, in the kind of xenophobia, trying to rally public support for something that they will define as pure in terms of Egyptian history and Egyptian culture.
Egyptian-ness. Robin Wright, Marwan Bashar, please stand by. Lots of listeners looking to join us here. We're looking at the Arab Spring a year after and where it's headed right now. Let me go to Tampa, Florida, and Ahmed. Ahmed, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Hi, Tom. Hi, guest.
Hi.
I was just wondering if your guest could address the issue of, you know, we were just talking about how the Egyptian government was cracking down on democratic NGOs in Egypt, but, you know, there's another story where the American government was basically selling millions of dollars worth of arms to the government of Bahrain while they were carrying out their own oppression of democratic movements there. I know there was a few senators, including Senator Rubio of Florida, who kind of, you know, brought that up as an issue, but it was basically like brushed aside with no real serious concern. And that story has basically been, you know, faded out of any sort of any sort of a media coverage. So I was wondering if they can go and address that issue, and I'll take my comments off the air.
Thank you, Ahmed. We'll do it. I mean, Marwan, here's the, in Bahrain, yes, there were U.S. arms sales there, and of course, we've just been talking about in Egypt, huge subsidies to the Egyptian military, which is now this playing this maybe obstructionist role. I mean, it raises the issue, Robin Wright raises it as well, of what kind of role the United States can play forward going in the Arab Spring democracy push. Is the U.S. too tainted in this new era, as you describe it, Marwan, to play a constructive role around democracy?
The short answer, yes. But I think the longer answer might be a bit more informative, or for all of us maybe to reflect on, including your listeners. Tom, I really don't believe in an innocence of a superpower like the United States. And I don't think NGOs in the built way down there in Washington think innocently about foreign relations. And I say that out of respect, by the way. I don't say that in any apprehensive way. I think a superpower that respects itself, knows how to serve its interests around the world, and works not with friends or allies, it works according to its national interest. And the national interests of the United States, according to those in Washington, agree with them or not, I disagree with them, is that they would provide arms to the autocrat in Bahrain, and where the Fifth Fleet is, by the way, and it's a very important fleet for the United States.
Yeah.
It does sort of flirt with the Egyptian military and hope that the Egyptian military to stay in order to stabilize the relationship with the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. And at the same time, of course, withdraw from Iraq, but get a bit deeper in Afghanistan, create Africa come and get more involved militarily in Africa and in North Africa, and more in the Mediterranean, you know, with the same confusion in Arab and Israel-Palestine and so on and so forth. So I don't think that as a superpower with a record that is not exactly spotless in the region, when the events have basically struck it right in the face, meaning that the Egyptians and Tunisians and other Arabs on their own, without American paternalism, without American NGOs, rose to the occasion non-violently, turned around and basically took on regimes, whether they are geeks or whether they are unemployed, whether they are old, young, male and female. We've seen them in the public squares of the Arab world taken on regimes without the International Republican Institute. And I think this is not the time, as I said, to distract ourselves from the real battles, from the real battle lines over there. And those are people against generals and dictators. Bringing the Americans into this will simply confuse the situation for the Arab public opinion.
Robin, if Marwan is representing a view from Egypt or the streets more broadly, that doesn't bode too well for American influence in this region.
No, it doesn't, but I think there is a role the United States can play in helping on another front. Most of these regimes going through transitions are very vulnerable economically, and many of the people who turned out in the uprisings really were looking not just for the right to have a ruler who is accountable and allows free and fair elections, but also to have a sense that they have a future, that a government is going to provide for them, whether it's health care or jobs. And that's where the United States can use its resources, its technical skills, to try to help the economies of many of these countries. That's where there is a common interest down the road.
Tom Ashbrook, this is On Point, and we're talking this hour about the Arab world right now, a year after the Arab Spring. Egyptian generals on the hot seat today in Washington, but still very much in power at home in a lot of ways that really matter. Near war in Syria, Islamists coming into power, protesters still in the streets. Marwan Bishara is with us. He's with Al Jazeera English, host of the Al Jazeera show Empire. His new book is The Invisible Arab. You can read an excerpt at our website, onpointradio.org. Robin Wright is with us, longtime correspondent, knows this region inside and out, author of Rock the Kasbah, Rage and Rebellion Across the Islamic World. She joins us today from Washington. John in Cambridge, Massachusetts, you're on the air, John.
Oh, thanks for taking my call, Tom. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that before we can figure out how we can help, we need to get a deeper understanding of what really is going on and what the voices mean that we're hearing. And I'd like to push your guests, and particularly the gentleman in London, to help us as Americans understand the multiple voices that will be coming out of fundamentally Muslim societies, that the Muslim Brotherhood means different things in different countries, that the Muslim Brotherhood is different than the more fundamentalist, as I understand it. I guess they're called Salafists.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, that's fundamentally important. That's my question. And a comment is, I think that Al Jazeera English could play a profoundly important role in helping Americans understand. And I'm very sad that it's not very accessible in this country. I mean, I live in the Boston area, and Comcast does not carry Al Jazeera English. I have to stream it. So it's a question and a comment.
John, I appreciate both. We will pick up the... Let me go to the question first, and Robin, I'll come to you on this as well. But Marwan, you know, here's John's simple... If you could help outline for us, as you see it, maybe we just start in Egypt, the contending forces here. I mean, we saw... the young people on the street a year ago, and a lot of those people were described as secular, sort of internationalist in their outlook, even had a Google executive in their ranks in Wael Ghanim speaking. What about that sector? What about within the Islamic sector, the Muslim Brotherhood with or versus the Salafists? What about the other contenders here? How does it break down, Marwan?
I think Tom's, and that's for John as well, since the elections happened basically right after the revolution, those young people, that young generation that led, that spearheaded the revolution, had no time to, and yes, you could say no experience, to mount political parties and political programs and agendas. These were not familiar faces to the Egyptian people. As I said a bit earlier, Egyptians in general were more familiar with those Muslim or Islamist voices that were struggling against repressive regimes, and they were there in the poor neighborhoods of various towns and cities and villages of Egypt, and hence they voted for them. Today the challenge is the following. Has the revolution affected the agenda of the Muslim Brotherhood and the Salafists? Yes, it did. Today, both the Muslim Brotherhood and the Salafists, for the first time in their history, recognize the democratic rules of the game. They accept.
And they're big winners in those rules as they've emerged
so far
in the parliament.
Right. Exactly, Tom. The big challenge today is twofold. One is to make sure that there is a constitution that is consensual and that would allow the Egyptian people to vote those Islamists out if they fail to do their job properly in the next few years. And two, to allow for that freedom of expression, that freedom of assembly, that freedom of putting together their political parties and so on and so forth, whereby the new generation of Egyptians will be able to create a new political movement in the country that hasn't been there before and compete in the next elections. My sense is that Islam, nationalism, and democracy have a rendezvous in the future, where Islam, patriotism or nationalism, and democracy, this triangle will have to find a way to work together. I just came back from Tunisia, Tom, and from Egypt and so on, where I'm going next week as well.
Mm-hmm.
And when I talk to Islamists, I hear the following. The head of the Islamist Al-Nahda, is a kind of a bit of a variation on the Islamic Brotherhood, told me that he not only accepts the democratic rule of the game, but that he thinks of himself as a democrat, and that there is no contradiction between his Islamist thoughts and democracy, and that he thinks of himself as a, like the Christian democrats of the early part of the 20th century or the middle part of the 20th century, that now we're living a time when Islamists will also be groomed on the lines of Islamic democracy. And that, perhaps in a region where is ultra-conservative, is not a bad way to start.
Well, Robin, I want to bring that to you. Let me get one call, if I may, first. Fikri is calling from Stamford, Connecticut. Fikri, you're on the air.
Yeah, hi, Tom.
Hi.
I just wanted to make a comment. I grew up in Egypt in the 50s and 60s. I live in this country now.
Okay.
And when I was growing up, we worshipped America. We worshipped Americans. We were under the British occupation.
Mm-hmm.
And we looked at America as the land of the free. It has no colonies. Wonderful things.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, when President Nixon visited Egypt, in his last few days in presidency, he was received by millions of people that were climbing for the out of love to America.
Wow. Okay.
Of course, that was, you know, the President Nasser, the United States did not want to fund the Aswan High Dam, and he changed the country to Russia, to be pro-Russia.
Yeah.
The government was pro-Russian, but the people remained pro-American. All what I wanted to say, there was a deep love for the United States.
What about now, Fikri? How do you see what's going on?
What happened? Yeah, now it's different. And the reason that's different, there is a sense of, you know, I'm not Muslim, but Egypt is a Muslim country. 90% of the Muslims, of Egyptians, are Muslim. There's a sense of anti-Islam movement that happened with the Iraq war and the Afghanistan war. Looked at President Bush as right-wing religious, and so on mm-hmm. and so forth. So there is a suspicion about this anti-Muslim movement by the United States. That's number one. And then you take it from another side, is that the Egyptians are deeply religious people. That's from ancient history. And the Muslims are deeply religious, and the Christians are deeply religious.
Mm.
And religion, that's why you see this difficulty in separating the government from religion.
Is that all right, Tufikri? Can you have an effective democratic government that's not secular, let's say, in Egypt?
I'm sorry, I do not like that one bit. But is that all right? I'm sorry, I didn't get your question.
Can you have an effective democratic government in Egypt that's not secular? That is...
Yes, I think so. I think that all those liberals that are there, if any government will be effective, it should be not secular.
Secular or not secular? Do you want a secular government or a religious government?
I personally want a secular government. I think that the separation of the church and the government is essential. Unfortunately, because of the history of the country and what they went through, and who are the Egyptians, are they just... It is like I would be sitting with someone like you, and you say, and then I say to you, excuse me, I have to go pray now. Mm-hmm. It's very religious people.
Mm-hmm. You know?
And the nature of Islam is that it can combine government. It's not really a pure religion. It's a religion and a way of life at the same time. It's a religion and government.
So it
That's
easily,
the nature of religion.
Yeah, easily gets into the governing realm. Fikri, you tell us a lot, and I appreciate your call very much. Robin Wright, how do you see the most fundamental contending forces here? And we shouldn't leave the military out because they're still sitting right in the middle of it.
Absolutely, but I think we sometimes in the West make a false division between the forces at play, dividing them too simplistically mm-hmm. in terms of religious versus secular, when in fact all of these societies are socially conservative and do want Islam to play a role in their life. Even during the rule of Hosni Mubarak, the Egyptian Constitution, Article 2, stipulated that all laws had to be in compliance with Sharia, with Islamic law.
Mm.
And that article is likely to stay. The question has always been, how do you implement it? And during the Mubarak regime, it wasn't implemented. It was there in spirit, but not necessarily in daily enforcement. And, of course, the big question is, do you have, as these countries elect Islamist parties, a kind of creeping Islamism that squeezes out the choice, whether it's of women or minorities or opposition groups? And that's one thing that we have yet to establish. But I do want to say, having just returned from Egypt and having talked to members of the new parliament, both from the Muslim Brotherhood and from the Salafist Nur Party,
mm-hmm.
that the thing that's so striking is that the Islamists are quite divided among themselves. Those two forces actually don't like each other. The Muslim Brotherhood has been an organization founded in 1928. 80 years later, it is pragmatic on some issues and willing to work with the military. In fact, there are many in Egypt who will charge that there's a kind of secret deal between the two. And they think that the Salafis, the Nur Party, are upstarts inflexible, mm-hmm. don't understand reality.
Mm-hmm.
The Noor Party, which was founded only last summer, it charges that the Muslim Brotherhood has just compromised too much and doesn't really represent an Islamic agenda anymore. And that's the reason that even though between the two of them they hold about 70% of the seats in parliament, they actually are not going to be part of a new coalition. The Muslim Brotherhood has turned to secular parties.
Interesting.
To create a coalition during the for this crucial process of writing a new constitution.
Wow, a lot of fault lines here. Marwan, let me ask you, here's a question online from Kevin, who says, ask your guest, please, whether non-Muslims have a place anywhere in Egypt post-revolution, or is it only the rights of the majority that matter? And I know you were born Christian Catholic in Nazareth, no less, Marwan. What about this question when it comes to take Egypt?
You know, the Christians were living in Egypt since before Islam, just like they were living in Syria and Jordan before Islam. The Christian tribes have lived in that part of the world for centuries before Islam. That came, of course, in the 7th century. And I can't see the region but with a certain, you know, plurality and diversity of cultures and of religions and so on and so forth, and that should be part of its richness. Not
should
part,
be,
not
but
part
we've
of its
seen,
problem.
But we've seen huge tension around that. We've seen churches burned. We've seen fighting in the streets, as you know very well, in Egypt in recent months here.
And of course, it's not to be compared with 100-year wars in Europe, right?
Well,
and the religious wars that we've seen in other places and that we've seen today in Nigeria and
mm-hmm.
we see
fair,
in
fair
various
still.
Parts of the world. And certainly nothing like the Balkan, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, there are tensions, and I think some of the tensions might continue. And that's why I think part of the reason why we have also complications in Syria, Tom. I think the sectarian issue is very important. It's divisive. And when it's politicized, become quite violent and horrible and destructive to the people. Having said that, the thing that kind of leaves me optimistic, Tom, is not the fact that there aren't many challenges and difficulties and barriers going forward. Of course there are, and some of them mm-hmm. you just voiced. What I like about all of this is that even the most ultra religious among them in Egypt, Christians and Muslims, maintain that they are not sectarian, maintain that they are not divisive. I mean, there is a certain consciousness in the country, especially after the revolution,
mm-hmm.
that forces people always to defend themselves and explain themselves whenever they are accused of being sectarian. That national consciousness, that spirit
That's
of freedom and
yeah.
openness, I think mm-hmm. is our guarantor in the region, not the fact that there aren't sectarian people and factions. Yes, there are.
That's a very hopeful element and a kind of another nod to the significance of the changes of this last year. Robin, I mean, you point to something in some recent writing here, or I'm reading anyway, 30% of the Egyptian economy is controlled by the military. And I've wondered from the very beginning, how do you deal with that? It's one thing to get Mubarak out of the palace, but how do you, or will they, get the military out of this deeply enmeshed economic power situation that can make everything else look kind of like window dressing if it's still a core of military really running the economy underneath it?
Well, that's a big question. The military has control at so many different levels. A couple of the things that could happen are, for example, that the parliament agrees to a deal that gives the military immunity from prosecution for the deaths and injuries of protesters over the past year since Hosni Mubarak stepped down and the military took over.
Yeah.
The second thing, it deals with the budget. Believe it or not, Egypt's military budget was a secret even from Parliament. And one of the new ideas is to introduce a kind of oversight committee that will have access to the figures, but not the entire Parliament. But then the question becomes, what about all the businesses, hotels, the vast amount of land that comes under directly or indirectly the military's control? And how do you account for it?
Mm-hmm.
There's a sense that Mubarak ripped off the Egyptian people and that maybe the military has done or is doing the same thing. And so one of the biggest questions is what what mechanisms do you put in place to hold them accountable and make sure that they don't keep doing it, that their stock doesn't increase? And finally, there's the question of how do you limit its control of whether it's foreign policy or legislation? Because behind the scenes, the generals always made their preference clear and basically acted as a kind of puppeteer. And how do you put that in check, particularly when all of the groups that are coming to power now are newcomers? They've never had to deal with this before.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a process that's going to play out over time. It's clear the Egyptians' military wants to hand over power sometime this year, probably mid-year, on paper. But the question is, how do you do it in reality?
I guess there's a lot to be said, though, in just how real and urgent these questions still are. It's a way, a testimony to the significance of what has happened here. They can't just be these questions brushed aside, at least not yet. We hope that remains the case. Robin Wright in Washington today with us from the U.S. Institute of Peace, author of Rock the Kasbah. It's always great talking with you, Robin. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you, Tom.
And Marwan Bishara with Al Jazeera, author of The Invisible Arab. Marwan, come back. We want to keep on top of this. Thank you very much for your insights.
Thank you for having me, Tom.
Listeners, thanks for joining us. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point.